gonna kill you. You don't wanna with me.
It's a lyrical A-bomb that leveled everything in its path.
He talking about killing his wife,
raping his mother, killing his mother.
My jaw hit the ground when I heard that the first time.
Since his birth, I've been cursed with this curse to just curse.
Eminem's The Marshall Mathers LP was the raging reaction of a man cornered by fame.
I wasn't used to people looking at me like I was an animal in a cage.
He wanted to be taken more seriously. This is how I want to be perceived.
It was my way of telling people to shut their mouths.
Skipping the bebop of Christopher Reeve. Sonny Bono sees horses and hitting some trees. Hey!
The album's colorful onslaught ruffled feathers nationwide.
2, 4, 6, 8, Eminem is full of hate.
This is not art. This is hate speech. Can you imagine that the entire industry honors this man whose work is so hateful?
That's what I'm trying to do, is push your buttons. So
but it set new benchmarks for beats, rhyme, and flow.
It was tight.
All the tracks are hot.
It's just dope, man.
Kind of touched me in a special way.
My bum is on your lips. My bum is on your lips.
Eminem's The Marshall Mathers LP is an ultimate album.
Agree with it or disagree with it. It's an extraordinary thing.
It cemented an MC spot in hip-hop history and shattered the notion that white men can't rap.
I'm like a head trip to listen to, cause I'm only giving you things you joke about with your friends inside your living room. The only difference is I got the balls to say it.
The album was brilliant. We had a new artist, a white cat, coming in doing black music and it being good, because that's rare.
Cause I am whatever you say I am. If I wasn't,
I refer to him as the Great White Hope.
In the paper, the news, every day I am. I don't know, this is the way I am.
He was like the first one that's really like rock solid, hardcore, really spit it, committed, and witty.
I mean, it was so different from anything that anybody had heard in hip-hop before, especially coming from this white guy. It got to a point where color or race didn't have anything to do with it.
Can't sing and Britney's garbage. What's this bitch guitar? Give me back my $16.
In a hip-hop world obsessed with material flash, Eminem's Marshall Mathers LP was an unsettling dose of dark substance.
Bing, bing, bing. Takes his chainsaw, lift his brains off, dangling from his neck while his head barely hangs on.
Kind of like something Stephen King would write. It sounded like a horror movie.
You ain't got the balls to beef. We ain't gonna never stop.
Each song, you either got a sense of his anger and aggression, his background, his personal life.
Shut up! Give me your hands and feet! I said shut up when I'm talking to you! You hear me?
The album wrapped cutting cultural analysis in the blackest of humor, but not everyone was amused.
Popping off at the mouth was I shouldn't have said.
A broad range of special interest groups found M's message offensive, even dangerous.
He is a violent misogynist.
Shut up! You're causing too much chaos! Just bend over and take it like a... Okay, Ma? Oh,
now he advocates raping and murdering his mother in one of his songs.
I don't even believe in breathing. I'm leaving air in your lungs just to hear you keep screaming for me to seep it.
He talks about how he will choke the women he murders slowly so that their screams will last for a long time.
I'm just playing, ladies. You know I love you.
There's nothing cool about this guy's lyrics. Nothing. There's only harm comes out of these lyrics.
Either I'm the only one that gets Eminem's sense of humor, or we're both should see the same psychiatrist.
Oh, want me to watch my mouth?
Bolstered by vivid violence and four-letter tirades, the Marshall Mathers LP was Eminem's vehicle for vengeance, the lethal retribution of an artist cornered by success.
I don't do black music. I don't do white music. I make fight music for high school kids.
M is a fighter, and when you come and you cross his line, he's gone. Push forward with whatever strength he got.
You want me to fix up lyrics while the president gets his dick sucked?
What I've always done is answer critics who were saying about me. One of my intentions was to make them feel stupid.
The Marshall Mathers LP was a raw self-portrait of a reactionary rhymer, one raised on Detroit's cultural fringe of black and white.
Just Marshall Mathers.
Marshall Mathers.
I'm just a regular guy. I don't know why all the fuss about me.
Fuss about me.
In the areas where he grew up, you know, it's a rough, blue-collar, lower-class neighborhoods. He was always caught on this dividing line that divides black neighborhoods from white neighborhoods.
When I was just a little baby boy, my mama used to tell me these crazy things. She used to tell me my daddy was an evil man. She used to tell me he hated me.
Marshall never knew his real father. He passed his childhood struggling in a house his mother Debbie filled with a rotating cast of foster kids.
They said I can't rap about being broke no more. They say I can't rap about no more.
By age 16, he was a high school dropout. In his early 20s, he found an outlet for his frustration, performing hardcore hip-hop in area clubs. He took the stage name Eminem, a play off his initials.
There was this white kid who was going into these hip-hop spots, you know, the hip-hop shop in St. Andrews Hall, and was basically tearing cats to shreds. You know, he was going to these spots and going in disrespected and coming out respected.
My name is Marshall Mathers. I'm an alcoholic.
I'm Marshall.
By 1997, 25-year-old M had released two independent albums and earned himself a healthy underground buzz. In October of that year, he was invited to freestyle on influential LA radio station, The Beat.
Met a retarded kid named Greg with a wooden leg. Snatched it off and beat him over the head with the peg. Go to bed with the keg, wake up with the 40. Mix it with Alka-Seltzer and Formula 44D.
M's unorthodox approach caught the ear of an eager intern at Interscope Records, who mentioned the rapper's distinct stylings to label chief Jimmy Iovine.
I said, call up the radio station, you know, and find out who he is and see if there's a tape around. So he did that. And I said, I'll tell you what, it sounds good. I said, but I'll play for Dr. Dre on Saturday.
Dr. Dre was instrumental in bringing hardcore hip-hop to mainstream America.
Ain't nothing but a G-thang, babe.
With 1992's landmark album, The Chronic.
Never been on a ride like this before. With a producer who can rap and control the maestro.
He pops in a cassette, had four or five songs on it.
And he said, give me that. And he took it with him.
If I had one wish, I would ask for a big enough ass for the whole world to kiss.
It was really different because he finds ways to rhyme words that don't seem like they should rhyme. I was blown away, you know, and I knew I had to work with him right then.
I'm tired of making knots with a stack of ones, having a lack of funds and resort back to guns.
Weeks later, M made the jump from a regional indie to the big leagues. He signed to Dre's Aftermath Entertainment, a division of Interscope Records, and headed into the studio with The Good Doctor.
Come on, everybody. Come on, everybody.
In February of 1999, M released his major label debut, the Slim Shady LP. He quickly introduced himself to the world.
My name is what? My name is what? My name is
Slim Shady. When I first heard a song, Hi, My Name Is, that's when I knew. I was like, I want to hear this guy's album, because you knew he had skills when you heard that first song.
Hi, kids. Do you like violence?
Yeah,
want to
yeah,
see
yeah.
me stick 9-inch nails to each one of my eyelids?
Beyond the catchy single, the Slim Shady LP was bulging with brutality, graphic sex, and illicit drug use.
99% of my life I was lied to. I just found out my mom does more dope than I do. I told her I'd grow up to be a famous rapper. Make a record about doing drugs and name it after.
As the album parked itself atop the pop charts, M came under fire from organizations like the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation. GLAAD maintained that the rapper's incendiary rhymes were fanning the flames of hate.
Eminem's anti-gay lyrics encourage young men to go out and really enact their emotions through violence towards gays and lesbians.
I mean, ever since the day I was born, drugs, what they used to say I was on.
Civil rights organizations weren't alone in dissing M. The hip-hop community was a private party, and the lingering embarrassment of Vanilla Ice assured Eminem would have a hard time getting on the guest list.
I think the general attitude is like, he's good, but you know, white rappers don't work.
Despite the skepticism, the Slim Shady LP would sell upwards of 4 million copies. Though Eminem had spent years pursuing success, he found himself unprepared for the incessant crush of stardom.
One minute, I'm on stage rapping in front of 30 people, and the next minute, I'm on stage rapping in front of 30,000 people. And it became a lot for me to deal with, you know? Being recognized in public and not being able to go to places that I used to go to or go back to the same places without being with. People would see me like I wasn't Marshall anymore. Well, look, it's Eminem on the court. Nah, dude, you know me.
Pass me the ball. Shut up.
In late 1999, while still on the road promoting the Slim Shady LP, Eminem began penning the songs that would become his next album, the Marshall Mathers LP.
People that love me, people that hate me, but it's the evil that made me, this backstab and deceitful and shady.
His objective was to craft a lyrical Up Yours for anyone and everyone who'd ever done the rapper wrong.
I'm not gonna let nobody get the best of me. I'm not gonna let anybody get the last word. You can't outsmart a smart ass. I have to outsmart everyone or I lose.
Next, an English angel brings out the devil in M.
Like, your picture on my wall, like, this is about an obsessed fan. Like, that's all I kept thinking.
When Ultimate Albums return.
Yeah, what up, Detroit?
Oh, no, big slim dog, 80-pound ball, what? 6-inch long, back up.
In late 1999, less than 1 year after provoking America with the Slim Shady LP, 27-year-old Detroit rapper Eminem began writing a vengeful response to his detractors.
What if he's right? I'm just a criminal, making a living off of the world's misery. What in the world gives me the right to say what I like and walk around flipping the bird?
But as M scribbled scathing new verses, the world wondered aloud if the Motor City Maniac was destined for the one-hit bin.
All right, you did it one time. Let's see if it's real.
A lot of people thought, okay, well, we heard all the little jokes, we heard all the little punchlines. That's not gonna happen on the second album.
He shaded.
He's so crazy.
While M toured the globe in promotion of the Slim Shady LP, a litany of hip-hop producers cooked up beats for what would become the Marshall Mathers LP. Among them was Mark James, aka the 45 King. While watching TV one night, the 45 King stumbled upon the song Thank You in a commercial for the movie Sliding Doors.
I was actually doing bills or doing something. Sitting on the bed watching it, and then my tea gone cold, I'm wondering why.
I said, wow, that's kind of hot.
The 45 King didn't recognize the angelic voice of English chanteuse Dido, but he knew the track was begging for rhymes.
And I taped it. I took it downstairs in the basement. I looped it up, added a bass line and drum tracks.
He quickly ushered it off to Interscope Records. They passed the tape on to Eminem.
Seeing the vision, like, in what Dido was saying, like, her words, like, instantly put me there. Like, your picture on my wall, like, this is about an obsessed fan. Like, that's all I kept thinking.
Dear Slim, I wrote you, but you still ain't calling. I left my cell, my pager, and my home phone at the bottom.
M spun Dido's nostalgic love letter into a caustic warning against taking his rhymes too seriously.
But what's the you said about you like the jurist too? I say that shit just clown is all. Come on, how's your vision?
He called the song Stan.
He stepped outside, and he took a look in. And he gave us all a look in. To hey, what it feels like to be the fan.
It's been 6 months and still no word. I don't deserve it. I know you got my last two letters. I wrote the addresses on them perfect.
What it feels like to be the person who's being admired.
Why are you so mad? Try to understand that I knew once you was a fan.
And he did it simultaneously.
I even got a tattoo with your name across the chest.
Anybody who lives and breathes for someone else who entertained is taking it too far and probably has something mentally wrong with them, make them do something up.
Shut up, bitch, I'm trying to talk. Hey, Slim, that's my girlfriend screaming in a drunk, but I just let her throw. I just tied her up, see, I ain't like you. As if she suffocates and suffer more, then she'll die too. Well, gotta go, I'm almost at the bridge now. Oh, I forgot, I'm not supposed to sit this down.
Fan obsession was one obvious byproduct of Eminem's sudden fame.
Thank you.
But the toll was far more personal elsewhere.
Aw, look at Tang's baby girl.
His one-year marriage to wife Kim, mother to his daughter Haley, was disintegrating. When longtime collaborators the Funky Bass Team presented M with an elegant new beat, he promptly penned the definitive anti-love letter to his bride.
Sit down, bitch, and move again, I'll beat the s*** out of you!
He listened to the track, wrote the lyrics immediately. It made him, it gave him that angry feel.
Look at your husband now! I said look at him!
It was quite intense to see the passion he had. It was freaky.
Get the away from me! Don't touch me! I hate you!
I just pictured her in my face and me being able to scream at her like that and you know, really tell her how I felt.
So long, bitch, you did me so wrong. I don't wanna go on.
The song would rank as the darkest of M's new material. A gruesome, vicarious voyage into the Mathers' volatile private life.
Now shut the f*** up and get what's coming to you!
I think my jaw hit the ground when I heard that the first time.
He's talking about killing his wife. Who don't feel like that sometimes? You know what I'm saying? He just was crazy enough to write a song about it.
The song Kim was tracked during a rare respite from the whirlwind promotional campaign for the Slim Shady LP. Then, in November of 1999, Eminem jumped the Atlantic for a series of gigs in Europe. He found a pot of inspirational gold in Amsterdam.
For some reason, you know, thoughts kept popping into my head. And the entire time while I was there, did drugs and wrote. Okay, no drugs. But I wrote a lot.
While M inhaled the Amsterdam atmosphere, the beat-making process carried on back in the States. M got a phone call from California.
Why?
It was Dr. Dre blasting a new cut.
He actually was on the phone telling me he was gonna send me some beats.
And I actually had the track playing in the background. And he was like,
yo, what is that? And I was like, put the phone in the speaker a minute. And he played it for me.
And he was like, what's that? I got, send me that track.
He sent it to me and I wrote a song the next day.
Atop Dre's quirky beat, M authored a drugged up bloodbath for those suggesting fame would soften his blows.
They said I can't rap about being broke no more.
The title cut right to the chase. Kill you.
You think I won't choke no to the vocal cords don't work in a throat no more?
The song Kim had already proved no one was safe from M's vengeance. In Kill You, he kept it in the family, carrying out a lyrical rape of his mother, who was often the target of his rage.
Shut up, it's causing too much chaos. Just bend over and take it like a okay, Ma?
He had already been in the media talking about his mother, all the different problems they're having, but on this song, he's talking about raping his mother. He's talking about killing his mother. Don't mess with me, I'll kill you, you know? And I couldn't believe he was saying this.
I'ma be another rapper dead for popping off at the mouth with I shouldn't have said.
Eminem headed back to the States and promptly hit several studios. In Detroit, he worked with the Funky Bass Team. And in Los Angeles, he recorded with Dre and his partner, Melman. By February of 2000, Eminem had a 16-track arsenal in place and was ready to launch it at those who'd done him wrong.
You never heard of a mind as perverted as mine.
I just fed off of the energy that negative people gave me, you know, and took it and basically, I guess, threw it back in their face.
What do I think of success? It sucks. Too much stress.
Confident his new set would eclipse the Slim Shady LP, Eminem eagerly submitted his new album to Interscope Records in March of 2000. Label honcho Jimmy Iovine heard an album one song short of a masterwork.
This album was a real growth from the first album, and that it had a slope to it, and it got real dark. So I thought we needed something lighter, and not funnier, but lighter, to introduce the record, to kind of get people into it.
Next, M feels the heat of high expectations.
I can't give you another My Name Is. I can't just sit in there and make that magic happen.
when Ultimate Albums returns.
You know, I just don't get it. Last year I was nobody. This year I'm selling records.
Barely 1 year after his graphic major label debut incurred the wrath of gay rights activists and women's organizations, Eminem completed his macabre response.
I think I was put here to annoy the world and destroy your little four-year-old boy, your girl.
In March of 2000, M and producer Dr. Dre delivered the Marshall Mathers LP to Interscope Records.
'Cause I'm just Marshall Mathers. I'm just a regular guy, I don't know why all the fuss about me.
I felt that the album was spectacular, but I thought that they hadn't taken it as far as they could. They needed a song to introduce the album.
I knew we had a second and third single, but we needed that big opener.
Hoping to sugar M's dark pill, Iveen suggested the rapper craft something more accessible, something closer to Slim Shady's infectious smash, My Name Is.
My name is
With the release date looming, the burden of writing a hit fell squarely on Eminem's shoulders.
I can't give you another My Name Is. I can't just sit in there and make that magic happen.
He was really tired, and we was talking. He was like, man, how do I beat How My Name Is? I was like, just do some old sarcastic. Do what you do.
I felt like under pressure, I felt like, what am I gonna do?
Scant days after delivering his new album to Interscope, M found himself back in a Los Angeles studio, rush recording new tracks. But instead of crafting a formulaic single, M fired off a scorching sermon on artistic freedom.
I wish that I would just die or get fired and drop from my label. Let's stop with the fables. I'm not gonna be able to top what My Name Is.
I ended up writing The Way I Am, which to me was like opposite a single. Like, it was basically me dumping my frustrations out. Like, look, this is the best I can do. I really let it out and wanted people to know, like, this is how I truly feel.
With the song The Way I Am, Eminem broke from his playful Slim Shady persona and lashed out against the intrusive faction of his fanatical fan base.
But at least have the decency in you to leave me alone when you freaks see me out in the streets when I'm eating or feeding my daughter to not come and speak to me.
I felt like sometimes I just want to be left alone. When I go out and I entertain these crowds, then that's what I'm doing. But when I'm at McDonald's, I'm not trying to entertain you. I'm trying to be as normal as I can be.
Is trying to tell them, listen, this is the way I want to communicate with you. Not why shaking your hands while I'm trying to take a piss.
And I'm thankful for every fan that I get, but I can't take a in the bathroom without someone standing by it. No, I won't sign your autograph.
When you as big as Eminem, how can you get to all of your fans? How can you sit out there after a show and just sign 17,000 autographs? You know what I'm saying? A man's hands gonna get tired after a while.
The Way I Am was a necessary catharsis for M, but hardly poppy enough to brighten the shadowy landscape of his new record. So the rapper resurrected the Slim Shady persona one last time.
It was like really crunch time because we were like really nearing our deadline.
So me and M came back in the studio, and that was one of those moments where he came and he had the hook already.
I was like, you know what? I got one more in me. Let me try this. And I was doing this hook that I had the idea for to Dre.
And it was simple. We just had to put music to that.
And Dr. Dre said, nothing, you idiots. Dr. Dre's dead. He's locked in my basement.
M's 11th hour jam was the real Slim Shady. A single was finally in place.
Jimmy came in and was like, this is it.
The minute I heard it, I knew that. I said, wow, that's incredible.
My kids were singing it, you know what I'm saying? So that was enough for me.
And there's a million of us just like me, who cuss like me, who just don't give a f*** like me, who dress like me, walk, talk, and act like me, and just might be the next best thing, but not quite me.
After listening to it 5 or 6 times, it became cheesy. And I was like, yo, this probably could be it, because after listening to My Name Is a few times, it ended up becoming cheesy to me too. And I was like, okay, this is the formula then.
The real Slim Shady was a hooky party jam that slung lyrical mud at Britney Spears, Christina Aguilera, and squeaky clean Will Smith.
I never killed nobody in none of my records. I don't use no profanity in none of my records. And still I managed to get up here.
Will Smith don't got a cuss in his raps to sell records. Well, I do, so damn it.
After a year of bi-coastal brainstorming and writing and recording 2 last-minute singles, Eminem's new album was complete. Though slapstick in spots, the album was otherwise a very personal affair, one deserving of a personal title.
He wanted to be taken more seriously. This is the Marshall Mathers LP. This is me, you know, as a person and how I want to be, you know, perceived.
For the cover, he was photographed on the front steps of his childhood home, where he weathered a stormy adolescence and fought for his mother's attention.
The guy who lives there now, like, let me in and let me see the house, and it looks a lot different on the inside, but, like, just remembering, like, it took me back there. It brought me back to that place and that time, and it was crazy for me. Mixed feelings, because I had, like, a lot of good and bad memories in that house.
To generate buzz for the forthcoming album, Aftermath Entertainment released The Real Slim Shady on April 25th. America was instantly smitten.
Loud as you can, how does it go? Slim Shady, yes, I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up, please stand up.
It was one of those songs that it wouldn't disappear on you till you almost had to, like, take the CD and break it.
The song's campy video was an instant smash at MTV. Viewers tuned into the network's Total Request Live by the millions.
He was all over TRL. He was hosting, he was floating outside the window, he was downstairs in the street asking questions to Eminem.
Hey, they love you down here, Em. Back to you.
Thanks, Ray. Idiot.
With The Real Slim Shady a runaway radio smash, insiders forecasted the Marshall Mathers LP would make commercial history.
Yes, there's a Slim Shady in all of us.
I knew how good it was. I thought it could sell a million copies the first week.
My first thought was, holy shit, I'm gonna be Elvis. That was all I remember thinking. Like, I was scared to death.
On May 23rd of 2000, the Marshall Mathers LP was released to frenzied response.
I never knew why.
It posted the highest first-week sales tally of any solo offering in music history. 1.7 million copies sold in 7 days.
When it became 1.7, whatever it was, in the first week, it became like, this isn't real. This is not how you sell records. This, like, am I a fucking trend?
I'm sorry, there must be a mix-up.
You want me to fix up lyrics while the president gets his dick sucked?
The record numbers who snatched up the LP delighted in Em's tongue-in-cheek brew of gore, incest, sexist slurs, and stabs at gays and lesbians.
Marshall Mathers LP by Eminem has been one of the most blatantly homophobic albums and lyrics that we have ever seen at GLAAD.
I don't got that bad of a mouth, do I? Shit-ass bitch.
He dropped a line about Sonny Bono, you know, Sonny Bono skis horses and hitting some trees. You know, I'm like, oh my God, you know, this guy like has no limits. Come on, dude. But I kept rewinding it.
How many retards to listen to me?
It was a guilty pleasure for M's expanding legions. But to social activists, M was just plain guilty.
Damn, how much damage can you do with a pen? Man, I'm just up as you would have been.
This is capitalism at its worst. We don't even care if it makes a lot of money. It's just wrong.
Cause I never knew why, knew I would get this big. I never knew why, knew I'd affect this kid.
We're here to say, for all the social justice organizations that try to make the world a safe place, that this is not art, this is hate speech.
Was I supposed to know?
Next. Eminem embraces the Marshall Mathers backlash.
My whole attitude was like, all right, if this is what you think I am, then this is what I'm gonna be.
When Ultimate Albums returns.
May I have your attention, please?
On the strength of the blockbuster first single, The Real Slim Shady, the album sold well over 3.5 million copies in its first month.
The return of the... Oh, wait, no, wait, you're kidding. He didn't just say what I think he did he?
That's not no Cinderella kind of album either. That record is hardcore. It just shows that America loves that. Sex, money, and murder.
When I was just a little baby boy, my mama used to tell me these crazy things.
But as the album detonated over mainstream America, civil rights groups raised their red flag. They believed M's venomous lyrics were sending a dangerously violent message to a very impressionable audience.
Eminem's satirical argument assumes a level of sophistication in his listeners, many of whom are not old enough to get a driver's license.
You don't want to f*** with me. Girls need you. You ain't done but a
slut to me,
bitch, I'ma kill you.
A bevy of irate factions bit back at both the rapper and his record label. Gay rights activists pressured label bosses, radio, and retailers to refrain from promoting the record.
We sit back and we wonder, where is their responsibility, corporate responsibility to the listeners, to the parents who are out there and hearing the promotion of Eminem?
Other groups testified at Senate hearings and organized boycotts aimed at getting M's record off the shelves. I never knew
I. Can you imagine that the entire industry honors this man whose work is so hateful?
I tricked you.
Artistic expression and freedom of speech only can go so far before you have Miss Cheney knocking at your fucking door.
Hi, how you doing?
People react in a positive way, in a negative way, but that's the way our system's set up. It's, you know, it's freedom of the press, freedom of speech.
I have the right to remain violent. Anything I say can and will be used against you.
Wake up, get a sense of humor. We're trying to censor music. This is for your kids' music.
Like anybody with half a brain should be able to listen to it and see that that's what I'm trying to do. Is push your buttons.
With the Marshall Mathers LP sparking heated debates nationwide.
What if I came up with a rap song that was against African Americans? How would you feel?
M joined Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg on the Up in Smoke tour in June of 2000.
What in the world gives me the right to say what I like and walk around flipping the bird, living the urban life like a white kid from the burbs?
In keeping with the nothing sacred motif of his album, M's nightly sets involved ritual abuse of pop culture effigies.
What M did was he added some extra features that they normally don't have, and then, you know, brought him out on stage and proceeded to throw him in the crowd so the crowd could bounce him around like beach balls.
Among M's other onstage targets was an inflatable likeness of his estranged wife, Kim.
He was like, I know you guys heard a lot of things about, you know, me and my wife, and, you know, we're having these problems, but my wife, Kim, is here. And I mean, the crowd's like, oh, yeah, you know. And then he comes out with the blow-up doll, and it went from, you know, claps to awes and explosions.
On July 7th of 2000, the Up in Smoke tour rolled into M's hometown of Detroit. Kim Mathers attended the show. Later that evening, months of anger and tension came to a head. She went home and slit her wrists. Kim's suicide attempt failed. 1 month later, Eminem filed for divorce. M's personal life was circling the drain, and his rhymes mirrored every tragic step. He followed the radio-friendly Real Slim Shady with the brooding The Way I Am.
I don't mean to be mean, but that's all I can be. It's just me, and I am whatever you say I am.
In one verse of The Way I Am, Eminem came to the defense of a fellow media target.
When a dude's getting bullied and shoots up your school, and they blame it on Marilyn and the heroin, where were the parents at?
Shock rocker Marilyn Manson had been blamed for inspiring the massacre at Colorado's Columbine High School in April of 1999.
He was catching a lot of heat at the time, so I figured I would maybe take some off him and bring it on me.
It did kind of make people realize how ridiculous it was that I got blamed for so much, and it probably made a bunch of people take a second look and think, oh, well, if Eminem mentioned this, maybe this is something that's might be of interest to me.
Remember me!
Beyond The Way I Am, the Marshall Mathers LP was littered with references to the Columbine tragedy.
Came home and somebody must have broken the back window and stole two loaded them both of my trench coats.
M's gory musings on the event vaulted the rapper further into the critics' crosshairs.
I can't believe this many eyes are on me. I think it's hilarious.
But all the heat only fueled the LP's momentum.
The more bad press that they put up in the air about M, you know, it just sparked the curiosity, like, what is the big deal? And when they got it, they found out what the big deal was.
He's so crazy.
By the end of the Up in Smoke tour in late August, the Marshall Mathers LP had sold over 6 million copies. It had only been out for 4 months.
It's great to be living in a country where you can't say anything you want, put it on a CD, and sell 6 million records of it. I mean, I don't think you can do that anywhere else on the planet.
May I have your attention, please?
That September, M punctuated his iconic status by fronting a massive cast of Carbon Copies at MTV's 2000 Video Music Awards.
It was crazy that they could find enough guys that want to dress up, dye their hair, and look like him.
And there's a million of us just like me, just like me, just don't give up, like me.
Did you have to get applicants for that?
The real Slim Shady waltzed off with two Moon Men, one for Best Male Video, the other for Video of the Year.
So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up, please stand up, please stand up.
1 month later, M joined forces with platinum rap rockers Limp Bizkit and Papa Roach for the Anger Management Tour. M made sure his stage set, like his album, struck close to home.
Bringing a replica of the house he grew up in on the stage, you know, is just bringing the audience in closer to, you know, the idea of being one with the artist.
The Anger Management Tour afforded M the opportunity to spit his bile at packed arenas throughout North America. To the disgust of hate speech watchdogs, M's set centerpiece was Marshall Mathers thumping Criminal.
My words are like a dagger with a jagged edge. Yeah. Stab you in the head, whether you're a bag or a
criminal. There really is a connection between the lyrics and between the violence and the prejudice that gay and lesbian people face.
Homophobic? Nah, you're just heterophobic.
The most clear manifestation of that for GLAAD has been the hundreds of hate emails we've received, many from Eminem fans.
Should I say I just make it up to make you mad? My white naked ass.
If I said six lines about raping or killing or whatever, and then came back with, I'm kidding, don't do this, it didn't matter. It was almost like I didn't say that. It was almost like he just said raping and killing and faggots, and that's all he said.
Despite their best attempts, the anti-M lobbyists failed to halt the album's momentum.
Did you guys get that shit?
By the time M dropped Stan as a single in December, the Marshall Mathers LP had sold upwards of 8 million copies.
Anyways, I hope you get this, man. If he passed, is the chat truly yours, your biggest fan, this is Stan.
I don't think anybody in the wild of streams would have predicted this. We didn't know it was gonna be, you know, this crazy.
Now you're off and running. Superstar.
Damn.
Next. An unlikely duet shocks America.
It was my way of telling people to shut their mouths.
When Ultimate Albums returns.
Cause every time I try to tell them no,
no,
they won't let me ever let them go.
Go.
I'm a sucker, all I gotta say.
Whoa.
By the beginning of 2001, Eminem's Marshall Mathers LP had all walks of America in a firm chokehold.
It wasn't just the hip-hop crowd checking for Eminem. Even the people that hate him went out and purchased that album.
Feminist women love Eminem.
Chicka, 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 Slim Shady, I'm sick of him.
M's rage raps incensed the right and left alike, but the Recording Academy could not deny his microphone prowess. He received 3 nominations and was invited to perform at the 43rd Annual Grammy Awards.
You think I give a damn about a Grammy? Half of you critics can't even stomach me, let alone stand me.
The accused gay basher RSVP'd with a shocking request.
He was joking around and said, if I'm going on the Grammys, you know, because of all this controversy, everybody saying how homophobic I am, I'm only gonna do it
if Elton does stand with me, not thinking that it was even really possible.
And he said it half jokingly. And we were like, whoa, maybe that's the way to do it. Maybe that's gonna work.
And we asked him and he said, yeah.
I just want you all to notice me and people to see that somewhere deep down is a decent human being in me.
Many saw Elton John's acceptance as an act of solidarity in the ongoing struggle for free speech.
Elton understood him as an artist and said, you know, don't you people get it? He's only saying these things because you're saying that he's homophobic.
But gay rights activists from GLAAD weren't buying it. They believed the Grammy performance invitation and nominations were advancing Eminem's hateful agenda.
His Grammy nomination sends a really dangerous message to the music industry that not only can you write and produce and release any lyric you want, but you'll be rewarded with it.
On Grammy night, February 21st, 2001, GLAAD and other groups opposed to M's intolerant lyrics organized vocal protests outside the venue.
Eminem is full of hate.
And to ensure their message was heard nationwide, GLAAD convinced CBS to air this anti-gay bashing public service announcement during the Grammy broadcast.
Bad queer faggot!
Its message, delivered by the mother of gay murder victim Matthew Shepard, was poignantly clear.
The next time you use words like these, think about what they really mean.
Yet inside the auditorium, Em and Elton's performance of Stan would be the most hotly anticipated event of the night.
Biggest fan, this is Stan.
But he's gone cold and wondering why I got out of bed at all.
He comes out with Elton John, who is like, you know, an open homosexual. That's like somebody saying, hey, you know, I hate blacks and you come out on stage with Farrakhan, you know?
Dear mister, I'm too good to call to write my fans. This will be the last package I ever send your ass.
It was my way of shutting people up, I guess.
M capped his performance with one final act of reactionary defiance, letting all of America know just how he felt with the lifting of two fingers. Amid a flurry of controversy, the Marshall Mathers LP trotted away with two Grammys for Best Rap Album and Best Rap Solo Performance.
First of all, I want to thank everybody who could look past the controversy or whatever and see the album for what it was and also for what it isn't.
It was just important to see, you know what I'm saying, these people actually recognize us. It's not just because he's white, it's because he got in there and he did his thing.
The Marshall Mathers LP is an intimate snapshot of a poetic reactionary. Too strong to be denied, too volatile to be ignored.
What will remain is the music. For every story today, I can give you 100 stories in the last 50 years of books that were burnt or cursed or banned. 10 years later, these great pieces of art.
I'm trying to clean up my image, so I promised the critics I wouldn't say for 6 minutes.
It's a brutal reflection of a brutal era. An X-rated time capsule for generations to cherish or despise.
The world has the misfortune of me, you know, procreating. My kids will probably be listening to it in 10, 15 years.
You see, I'm just Marshall Mathers.
Marshall Mathers.
I'm just a regular guy.
For better or worse, Eminem's Marshall Mathers LP is a blistering blast of foul-mouth swagger.
Here, let me turn this up right now.
That cussed its way into hip-hop history.
There is a positive message in my music, and it's for you.
Peace, Boston, we love you. Peace.
Recoil!